You're watching Magicbricks Now, India's first property channel. I'm Fede Souza. Thank you so much for tuning in. This is the Urban Debate. We're focusing on Property 2016. And I have very, very interesting guests with me in the studio. These two gentlemen are going to help us find out where the growth is going to come in 2016. Pranay Vakil and Anuj Puri have been on the channel since we launched it. Need no introduction, gentlemen. Thank you so much for coming in. Obviously, anybody who's looking to buy property at this point is going to sit back and ask, and as they have rightfully picked up the phone and called us and said, are prices going to come down in the new year? This is still what investors want to know. And I personally believe, because we have such a wide market across the country, across cities, and then you can slice it from north to south and different pockets, it might be unfair to expect prices to go up or down across the board. But Anuj, are there specific pockets or specific builders you believe are going to do well? Is there any way we can demarcate what's going to do well and what's not going to do well in the new year?
Absolutely, Faye. I think you've said the right thing. Invariably, the question is asked whether property prices are going to go up or down, and very difficult to answer because each city is behaving differently. Within that city, the micro markets are behaving differently, and within that micro market, a good developer versus a not so good developer, their product prices are behaving differently. So you're absolutely right. One needs to go more deeper and suss it out that which are the cities where we believe that there's going to be an economic activity, there is going to be growth in those cities, which are the micro markets where you're going to see infrastructure develop. And usually with infrastructure development, there is more economic activity and job creation that happens. Mm-hmm. And then within that, which pockets we believe are being dominated by good developers and which are not dominated by good developers. One point that I would say, Faye, and you know, you and I have discussed this before as well, is that we don't believe that as we come out of this lull in the real estate market, which we've seen in 2013, 14, and most of 2015, that everyone is going to come out of it. Not all developers are going to come out of it. Previously, in 2008, when we had the Lehman crisis, you know, second half of 2009, everybody came out.
You know, Anuj, in fact, we were having this conversation yesterday on the channel. We were talking about how to choose a builder. And my point is, in the last 1 year, the rules of the game of buying property have changed completely. Earlier, there used to be a point where we said, okay, if he's a known builder, if it's a brand I've heard before, if he's one of the larger builders in the city, then I know that, you know, it's not a problem. That's not the case anymore. Some of the biggest developers in the country are currently not delivering on time. Some of the largest brands we know of are not delivering on time. Most of them are spending time in consumer court right now solving problems or, you know, listening, appearing for cases. The rules of the game of who is going to survive this downturn or, you know, this shakedown that we're seeing in the industry have completely changed, haven't they?
Absolutely correct. And I would say is you need to probably look at five factors when you're going out and buying your property. One, what's the track record of the developer been? As you're right, some of the bigger developers, their track record hasn't been very good. So you'll be able to suss it out. The second, where is the project? Whether the project has got the approvals? What's the location of the project? Third, I would say, is the size of apartment has become very important. Fourth, I would say,
why is the size of apartment?
Because, you know, Faye, most of the time we've seen is that the sizes have gone wrong, where they have built a larger apartment than what the consumer is willing to pay for. And that's where I feel is that the design and the size has become very important from a buyer's perspective in there is. The fourth is really what's the per square foot price that you have is. And fifth is whether the developer has the financial closure on that particular project or not. And those five things are going to be very important when you're going out and checking out a project. Mm-hmm. Prior, in previous years, it was exactly what you said, is that if you had heard the developer's, you know, branding and name, you would go for it. Today, I think it's become more complicated.
All right. I want to very quickly ask you about, you said financial closure. Now, the other four points we've heard before, interestingly, you know, size is an interesting concept. But when you say financial closure, as a retail investor, how do I find out whether he's got financial closure on a project or not?
Several ways to be able to find it out, Faye. The first one is whether the bank has given them the funding, whether the project has an ability to get a housing loan done, whether the project has got the approvals there, and whether you've heard that the developer at its balance sheet level, perhaps not even at the project level, has been over-leveraged or not.
Okay.
So you know, there's a little bit more work to be done. Mm-hmm. As I said, you know, it's become a little bit more complicated today than what it
than
was
what it
maybe
be.
8 or 10
true,
years
true.
Ago.
And fair enough, it should be complicated. It is our life savings that we invest in a home. But I want to ask you this, you know, if we look at the pattern we're seeing emerge from our city. So one thing is the rules that have changed when it comes to choosing a builder. Now, if I'm making a pure investment, the rules have changed in terms of picking that investment location as well. If we look at Mumbai, for example, highest spikes we've seen, Wadala, Chembur, Ghatkopar, wherever we've seen the Eastern Freeway, Santa Cruz, Chembur, Link Road, there's a monorail, all of these locations have been impacted by infrastructure. If you look at cities like Bangalore and Pune, it's happened because of job creation. Wherever the ITS, you know, businesses have moved, like Thanisandra, like the Hennur Road, these are areas in Bangalore that have seen growth. Are these the new rules of picking a location if I'm making an investment?
Well, this also is important. This is not possibly the only thing.
Okay, so tell us what's the most important thing.
Well, if you're picking up something, and if you're picking up something that's ready, complete, mm-hmm. and it has all the approvals, I think 50%, 70% of your risk is eliminated completely.
But then also 50, 70% of my return is eliminated completely. No. Because if I'm taking something and ready to occupy...
It all depends on how you look at it. Because you book something under construction, you're not going to get any rentals until the time it's complete.
Okay.
But you buy something ready, you're able to deploy it. Mm. So your investment is also in a small way productive. Maybe 2, 3%, but at least it's productive. It's paying for the outgoings, you know. And then all your risks are very much eliminated. You know, mm-hmm. all the ifs and buts which you have on the titles are more or less taken care of when you're buying a ready product.
You
Even
know,
the square footage, how you measure it, everything is taken care of.
We had Ramesh Jogani on this channel a day ago. He was talking about his new fund. He's raised 175 crore rupees to invest in the Mumbai residential market. And he said the arbitrage between what's under construction right now and what's ready to occupy is about 40, sometimes 45%. And that's the arbitrage that they're taking advantage of. So, would you say then it's risk versus return? If I want to take on the risk for the higher return, I should go in under construction. If I don't want that risk, I want secure investments, I want a steady rental return, then possibly look at something that's ready to occupy?
Yeah, but then look at all the funds that are stuck because they took the risk. I'm not saying don't take the risk, right? But some of the funds that we're talking about are stuck in a very bad way with certain projects, you know, which are not progressing. And with the fund, the real problem is that the meter is ticking. You have a 5 to 7 year lifespan. And unless you are able to turn your investment around in that period, you know, you're badly stuck or you'll have to exit any which way, even at a loss.
Okay, I'm told that Abhishek from Pune has picked up the phone and called us. He has a question for us. Abhishek, go ahead. Tell us what your question is.
My name is Abhishek. I'm from Pune. So I'm looking for to buy a second home, which is just for investment perspective. So I have picked up two locations. One is Baudan, one is NIBM. Mm-hmm. And I'm not planning to sell it out immediately. My plan is to keep it for like 5 years, take the rent. Or so which location would be better for me? So let's take it 5 years down the line, I evaluate which would give me good return, either Baudan or NIBM in Pune.
Okay, Anuj, do you want to take that in Pune? What would give him better returns? So he has a clear idea, five-year horizon, wants rental returns, second home. So it's a pure investment. Which one would you recommend?
So Pranay Bhai is a lot more closer to Pune, but I would say is, in my opinion, Pune Faye, as a destination is very nice. I am very fond of Pune. There is a huge amount of good work that has gone in Pune. It's become clearly an IT destination, second to Bangalore now. Most of our clients who are expanding out of Bangalore are looking at Pune. It's Hinjewadi particularly has become a very big economic IT thrust area. So clearly as a city, Abhishek has chosen the right city to go about it. But Pranay Bhai, maybe you want to throw a little bit light.
I would say that why is he stuck only on those two locations?
I know. I was just going to ask. You know, we know that there are some big...
Why not the new airport road, you know?
Karadi?
Which is also the upcoming kind of areas. yes, I mean, if you're talking about IT and IT-related product, you know, which are products in the 50 lakhs to 1 crore range, you know, yes, some of those areas which are near Hinjewadi are the better areas. Again, I'm coming back to the point that if he is picking up something ready, again, the appreciation will be less, but it is more certain compared to something which is really under construction, where a number of developers in Pune have delayed their projects in excess of 3 years.
Sure. So if you were just talking about, you know, second home investment, you're talking about Viman Nagar right now then in Pune? When you say new airport road,
I see some confusion in the second home and the investment.
Okay.
These are two very different things. So, do you want to use your home or you just want to kind of park that away?
No, he said he wants to park it and give it out on rent and hold it for 5 years.
All right. Then it's not a second home. Okay. Second home is something which you use yourself, right?
All right. Okay.
And therefore the criteria, I mean, when you're looking at a second home, you look at which side it faces, which way the wind is coming, is it vastu friendly, all of that, right?
Okay.
Because it's your second home, right? But as opposed to an investment, we don't care as long as it appreciates.
All right, so if it's a clear investment, like Abhishek has told us, what neighborhood in Pune would you
then
recommend?
I think there are two places in Pune. NIBM also is a good location, except that it's connectivity-wise, perhaps not as good as the new airport road, Viman Nagar side and all of that. There are certain non-traditional areas which are also coming up. There again, driven by the IT, and what has happened is that because of this connectivity to Bombay, which has opened up, I think that entire stretch is a good
stretch
to invest in. Okay. I mean, it's the new Bombay Pune Road.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
And as you enter Hinjewadi and all of that.
Okay, that entire Hinjewadi stretch. Abhishek, does that help? You know, the prices that are flashing on our screen right now show us that all of the neighborhoods that you're considering are largely in the same price bracket. So there isn't much to choose from in terms of prices. But to focus on wherever the IT/ITES job creation is happening, that's really been the growth area. That's been the driver for growth in Pune over the last couple of years. And of course, you can get back in touch with us if you need anything else. Anuj, interestingly, if we stay with Pune, since we brought it up, areas like Kharadi, for example, there's a lot of construction, a lot of very, very reputed builders from across the country, specifically from Bangalore, people who understand what the IT employee wants and needs. There are a lot of very interesting construction coming up in that entire neighborhood. We see Kharadi has actually gone up 3% in the last 1 year. Do you expect further growth in that neighborhood?
So, Faye, if I can take a step back and, you know, the discussion that you and Pranay Bhai had on the under construction, because that's also related to the question that you're asking me now. I do believe what you're saying is Mr. Jogani had said is a couple of days ago, that there is a good investment opportunity to buy under construction. I know Pranay Bhai feels it otherwise, and he's right. From his perspective, he's saying is, you know, this is, if you are not an educated investor, then don't get into something like this. But the gap is 40-50%. So, you know, clearly, I mean, if you are getting into an investment and you are an educated investor, then you should try and see if you can get on to the right project, which is under construction, because that's what the gap is. Where Pranay Bhai is coming is absolutely correct that a lot of people have got caught out because they were not educated, they were not able to take the right bets, and those projects have taken, initially they thought it was going to be 3 years, it's taken 7-8 years. By which time the return does not commensurate with the risk that you have taken.
So you're saying if you choose your builder carefully.
Correct. Absolutely. There is the upside to be done. Is because if you're going to buy almost complete or completed, I can tell you there's very little room left for an investor to make any capital gains on that. So I'm
going to ask you a slightly contentious question here. Again, for people who are waiting, and I know people in Pune are waiting, people who are waiting for prices to come down, thinking that I'll buy if the price comes down. The truth is, good, solid builders in the last 3 months, in the last 4 months, since the festive season began, we've seen this happen across all four big cities. If it's a strong builder, they've managed to sell, which means that if the price is coming down, that's not a builder we should be interested in. Is that true? Would you agree?
So, Faye, what's happened is, you know, previously we used to look at a cycle where everybody would go up, everybody would come down, all the builders. Now you're going to see this cycle changing. You know, you're going to see that the good developers will continue. At this point in time, their sales momentum has started to increase, not necessarily the price.
Sure.
And the not so good builders, their prices remain the same, but the sales momentum hasn't picked up. What you're going to see in 6 months' time is that the good builder price will start to go up because their sale momentum is already getting up. The bad builders, well, neither the sale momentum will go up. They will start to reduce the price. But the trouble is exactly what you're saying is, do you want to at that time invest into a project which either will never come up or will come up in a much more delayed period? So that's where the risk is of for an investor. that do you get on to a scheme where the prices started to go up, or do you wait for the prices to go down in a scheme where you're taking too much of a risk, which I can tell you as a as an educated person within the trade, I would be very reluctant. Because in my opinion, our law, you know, either the real estate regulation bill should have come in, and then we were protected, does not protect a consumer.
True.
And you don't want to get into something where you're being greedy to say is that I want the price to go down, but then you discover you've lost a lot of your own capital.
You know, we had a buyer on the phone line on this channel who said that I have nothing to help me out right now. Consumer court takes 4, 5, 6 years. There's absolutely nowhere to go, which means that prevention is your only course at this point. You have to be super careful about what you're choosing.
Very good point.
Pranay, obviously, we talked about how to pick a builder. But if there's anything that sort of raises a red flag on that deal, as a buyer, we should back out of it completely, right? We're no longer in a market where the builder says take it or leave it.
Right. So we are not now talking about something which is little below the completed product where all the risks were eliminated, right? And we're looking at a builder, look at his track record. Something as simple as this, that when you're buying a particular apartment in a development, try and contact the buyers of the same developer elsewhere and see what their experiences has been. I mean, this is something very elementary, very basic, you know, but it'll tell you the story. How they were treated when delays took place, you know. Were they treated well? What were the explanations given?
Sure.
How much they had to wait? All of that track record, you know.
All right. I'm going to interrupt you for a second. Rajesh Shah is on the phone line from Mumbai. I'm told he's gotten in touch with us. Rajesh, tell us what your question is.
Yeah, good afternoon.
Good.
I myself is Rajesh from Mumbai, Bandra. I wanted to invest 2.5 crore within a western suburb Mumbai.
Okay.
So, and in commercial project.
Mm-hmm.
So, and I don't want any undergoing project.
Mm-hmm.
I want any ready position and where the returns are good.
Okay. What is your time horizon on this investment? How long can you hold it for?
I can hold it for next 5 years.
For the next 5 years. And is there a reason why your heart is set on the western suburbs and not the eastern suburbs?
Western, because I stay in Bandra, Mumbai.
Okay.
So I think that will be convenient for me to travel around.
Well, I'll tell you something. If you live in Bandra, Mumbai, you could get to Chembur a lot faster than you could get to Kandivali right now. But Anuj, if he's looking for commercial property, and I'd urge you to look across the city, but if he's looking for commercial property at a 2.5 crore rupee ticket size, what would you recommend?
I would say, to begin with, I think Rajesh's budget is inadequate.
Okay.
For buying a decent commercial property. And I'll tell you where he's going to run into the risk is. 2.5 crores, unfortunately, on the western suburbs is not a good enough budget to buy a decent sized commercial property. If you don't buy a decent sized commercial property, you're going to lease it out to a C-grade occupier.
Who might
the
not
trouble is,
rent
he's never going to either leave your premises after the lease gets over or will start troubling you in terms of the rental. And that's where the trouble is going to emerge. My request to Rajesh would be is that if he does want to invest the 2.5 crores, it's better to look at residential. I'm a big fan of western suburbs. So, you know, it's great that he's identified western suburb as an area. But he should look at residential because commercial is going to be inadequate. In my opinion, if you want to...
What about if he considers, a shop which is rented out to either a medical store or an ATM or one of those, you know, where it's set and it's not going to, you know, be a problem in terms of return. Is that an option that he can consider?
There is, absolutely. But, you know, most of these would be owner-occupied.
True.
So there aren't those many chemist stores that you're going to be able to find which are actually taking it on lease.
So if we then put the commercial property aside and we consider only residential property, what are the options for him then?
I'd say several options. I mean, Oberoi got out on the Borivali and that was a great option to do it. Even today, it's a great option. I know the price has increased a little bit, but it's still a great option in there. And I would say is on the Western Express Highway, there are several schemes that are coming up of good developers, whether it's, Kanakya, whether it's Rustamji who are doing it, you know, whether it's the Wadhwa Group, you know, who are launching it, whether it's the Radius. So several of these developers who have good quality, credibility, have got the financial wherewithal to be able to deliver a project. That's where he should look at it. So it's a little bit unfortunate that I'm not being able to encourage Rajesh. But I would say that's the right advice. Don't get with 2.5 crores into a commercial property. Okay. I would say minimum size fare should be
But you're recommending that he stays on the Western Express Highway and not go into the Western Side suburbs?
Even Western Side suburbs, he can go in. I wouldn't say too deep into the Western suburbs because, you know, from the expressway to go in there, it becomes a big challenge. But I was just going to complete it by saying is that if you're going to look at a commercial property fare, then you should have a budget of at least 8 crores. I think 2.5 crores is going to be that insufficient to be able to make any meaningful investment into commercial property.
But I know you're agreeing with Anuj in terms of not enough ticket size to get into commercial, but tell me in terms of locations on the Western suburbs.
Yeah, but can I backtrack a little?
Of course.
You know, if he's got 2.5 crores, can he borrow 5 crores?
Okay. Would you recommend
to 7.5, 8 crores?
Okay.
Right? And this 8 crores, he'll be able to deploy in something little more acceptable to the buyer.
Let's ask him. Rajesh, are you open to borrowing, 5 crore rupees, taking the ticket size up to, say, 8, 8.5?
Can borrow. I can move up to, 4 crores or somewhere. It means 1.5 crore, I can more manage to get it.
Okay. All right. So, if the ticket size,
so
then...
I cannot move up to 8 crores. Okay. And it will be, it means even if I pull up and if I go with the loan part, then it will... I can go up to 1.5 crore more. So it can be around 4 crores and so.
Okay, right. 4 crores.
Like Anuj mentioned, you know, if the size is bigger, then you'll get the right kind of person to rent it. If the size is too small, you'll have some sales tax practitioner.
So tell me the difference between bigger and too small. What's an ideal size for commercial property?
Anything below 3,000 square feet, to my mind, would be small.
Okay, all right. And tell me what your preference is, Pranay, in terms of location in the Western suburbs.
Well, anything which is abutting the Western Express Highway, going all the way to Malar, then coming to Kandivali, Borivali, all of that, right with the frontage on the Western Express Highway is something which the IT guys would pick up.
The IT guys. We keep coming back to the IT guys. Anuj, now that he has, say, a 4 crore rupee budget, would you recommend he stays in that Goregaon East neighborhood where the IT guys already are and look try and find space there?
Yeah, absolutely. If he can find out some space, I would say, as Pranay said, it'll be, say, 3,000 to 5,000 square feet is an ideal size. So you're really looking at about 10,000 rupees a square foot, 10,000, 15,000. That's what the range is. The trouble is going to be is that you're not going to get decent IT companies taking up that space because they want 50,000 square feet. They're not necessarily looking at a 5,000 square feet. So really, Rajesh will have to do a little bit more hard work. Mm. The other option that Rajesh can look at is a pre-leased property already, which he can try and get in out for 4 or 5 crores, where he knows the quality of the tenant who's already sitting in it. Mm. That reduces the risk substantially.
All right. Rajesh, we hope that helps. If you can take it up to 4 crore rupees, then look at commercial. If not, look at residential property, abutting the Western Express Highway. Make sure you pick your builder really, really carefully. We're talking about where you should invest your money in 2016. How do you pick the neighborhood? And how do you pick the builder? In the studio with me, Anuj Puri and Pranay Vakil. We're trying and also answering as many questions as we can. I believe Dhruv is on the phone line from Mumbai. Dhruv, tell us what your question is.
Yeah, good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
My question is, I was planning to invest in Lodha Developers, the builders, a new project at Shield Fata in Dombivli, which is called Downtown. It is opposite Pallava, the famous project which is on.
Mm-hmm.
So is it worth investing? The possession would be in 2018. So is it worth investing and taking the possession? Is it good for investment or to actually stay over there?
Or to actually, are you considering living there?
Yeah, I have both the options. If it is possible, I would go and stay. But if the infrastructure and all other facilities are not comfortable, then I would give it on rent for some time.
Pranay, what would you recommend?
Well, I would not be able to comment on individual developers because I don't think it is fair, but I can talk about the
locations. I think it's very fair. I think you should comment on individual developers. How will the investor make up his mind?
Start identifying each of the developers, then somebody can get hurt or somebody feels nice and stuff
just
like
for
that.
Just on record, I don't care. But okay, go on.
But I would say that some of these peripheral areas which are coming up have seen maximum amount of appreciation in the recent past. Take Ulve, for example. you know, I think it has seen reasonably good appreciation in the last 2-3 years. I also see more appreciation coming in some of those areas as we go along. Depending upon the budget that you have, yes, the pricing in this particular area is very affordable today. You're paying over a period of time. And as long as you get something that is promised within a finite time frame, you can't go wrong on the investment. What really happens is that with certain delays that some of the developers end up with, your pricing goes completely haywire. Let me give an example. Let's assume that you see in the brochure a delivery of 3 to 5 years, say 5 years. Mm. And if you look at the payment schedule, you would have paid 80% of the amount in the first 18 months, which means that you're waiting for the possession. Yes, you have the 20%.
Okay, just the next three to four years. That this particular building that he's considering has an offer right now saying book a home, pay 5% up front, and then obviously the rest of the payments come up later. So in that case, if he's only putting 5% up front, then that brings down his risk considerably.
I think then, yeah, it is, as long as you're not required to pay the balance amount before possession, you're safe.
All right. Anuj, tell me this. If you're considering the Palava project, there's one argument, of course, about Mumbai as a market, that Mumbai will continuously grow. So it doesn't matter how further away, the city will eventually get there. So at the prices that we're looking at, again, it's about starting at 42 lakh rupees for a one bedroom, 55 lakh rupees for a two bedroom. This is the project that he's considering. Would you say that there's some reason to wait until infrastructure or social infrastructure gets there? Or do you think it still makes a good buy at this point?
Sophia, I've gone and spent time at Palava. So I've physically gone, seen it, and spent a full day. It is just an outstanding development. Okay. What the developer has been able to do it. It has an operational school, a very high quality operational school. It has a hospital. It's got a mall that they built up. There were people who were living in there. There were clothes that were hanging and drying out. So you could make it out that, you know, that there were people living in. It wasn't a ghost town.
Sure.
What they have been able to do is bring a huge amount of social infrastructure before
into the gated community.
Sure. So to answer your question, Faye, it's not that the social infrastructure needs to reach there. They've first gone ahead and built up the mall, the hospital, the school, the roads. Then they've started to build up these residential apartments. Mm-hmm. What they're now doing, the next phase, what I saw, and there was a beautiful club that they had built up. So it's not that these are all schemes.
What are the risks of buying this property at this point?
The one risk is there, which is where I think the developer also understands that is that they want to make this into an economic activity zone, which means is that they want to bring in offices. They want to bring this as an office culture, office hub within that city. Otherwise, what's happening is people are going to stay there and in the morning, everybody has to go into Bombay, which is then going to be a nightmare. That's where they're trying to woo the large IT companies and saying is, we've got a ready population here. We've got the social fabric. We're going to build offices for you. Please come in and start your offices.
And that's a risk because?
That's a risk that whether the office occupiers would want to come in there or not. If they come in, it's a huge success. Then, you know, you'll be buying it for investment, being able to lease out to the people who are going to be working there. It's a great opportunity to stay there.
So for Dhruv, he's looking at between a moderate investment and a great investment. These are the two possibilities on this buy?
I would say is go ahead with that, Dhruv. Because there's a huge amount of spend that already has been done by the developer. I think it's relatively as an easier ask to get the IT occupiers to now get in to do that. The tougher one was to build the social infrastructure.
And of course, Anuj is not as shy as Pranay. So when we talk about the builder in question here, which is Lodha, would you say that there's any risk there of delivery or you think it's okay?
No, I think they have done well. So, you know, I'll be quite okay on this particular scheme. The delivery has been very good. I also believe that this project has been a cash cow for the Lodha Group. So there's a huge amount of financial cash flows that are coming in through the sales.
Mm-hmm. All right, Dhruv, two thumbs up. Go ahead with that buy. And if you have any more questions about it, you know you can get in touch with us. That's what we're here for. Darshan is on the phone line from Juhu. Darshan, tell us what your question is.
No, I just wanted to know what would be the chances of appreciation there. So many schemes are coming there.
Is this still Dhruv?
Yeah.
Okay, what chances of appreciation? Okay, so that's an interesting question. Palava is a massive project. there'll constantly be supply coming in from the builder over, from the developer over the next, what, 10, 15 years at least, Anuj?
Yes.
He'll keep building towers, he'll keep selling homes. What sort of appreciation can Dhruv expect from the home that he buys then?
So I would say it's two things, Dhruv. One is that the entire township is under the control of the developer. And majority of the sale has happened to the end users. So clearly it is within the developer's hand how he starts mm-hmm. to progress the pricing. And I think that is what they have been doing over the last 5 or 6 years. So they will. It's not fair, a township where you're going to be competing from anything outside. What is sure. there outside is rubbish. I would never go in there is. So the ability of the developer to increase the price is within the control of the developer, not of somebody else. Okay. The second is that if the office guys come in, you're definitely going to get a huge amount of rental returns starting to come in from the residential.
If the office guys come in.
So that's really where you are. So clearly the developer's interest will be over a period of time gradually continue to start increasing the price.
All right, Dhruv, we hope that helps. All right, let's quickly move on from there then. I also want to talk about Bangalore. It's a city that we know that most of our viewers are very interested in. Even those people who don't live in Bangalore want to invest in Bangalore. Pranay, when you're looking at Bangalore right now, where do you see the future growth prospects? So we know Whitefield, we know the Sarjapur outer ring road area, all of those things that people normally mention on the show. Tell me what you're looking at that we're not looking at this
Okay, place. I'll give you two names, which are the upcoming areas. And one of them is called Panathur, Varthur.
Okay. Varthur,
yes.
The Varthur area, all right.
That's right. That's one of them.
Okay.
And then Thanesandra.
Thanesandra, all right. Fair enough. Okay, so Varthur and Thanesandra. Tell us your reasons why.
Well, the prices are reasonable. Mm. Whenever you're looking at a particular investment and the land component in the sale price is below 30%, the possibility of appreciation would be good, you know. When the land component is like 60, 70, 80%, that's when the speculation starts. Mm. That's when the risk starts. You know?
Okay.
So therefore, these are the areas where even today, stuff is available for 3,000 and 4,000 rupees a square foot. And I think this is, you can't go wrong at that kind of price.
All right, Thanesandra is on your screen right now. 4,750, this is according to Magicbricks, our data partner. And I think Varthur and Panathur are roughly around the same, say 4,500 rupees a square foot in Panathur. Varthur is around the same area as well. Thanesandra, my word of caution to anybody buying in Thanesandra is water. There's not enough water in Thanesandra. Keep an eye on where your builder is getting his water from. That's going to be an issue in Bangalore going forward. You want to, you know, stay on the safe side of the water supply. Anuj, what's your pick in Bangalore going forward?
I am a big fan of that city. I just think there's a huge amount of activity. I mean, this year, 2015, has been an exceptional year for Bangalore. Mm-hmm. The amount of leasing that has been done, if you were to look at the total leasing that was done in 2015, 40% of that was done just in Bangalore alone. The rest of the country only got 60% of the leasing. So, you know, clearly it's a city which has got the right ingredients. I think it's also got the right set of developers, Faye. Mm-hmm. I mean, we talk about the developers, but I can tell you is that there aren't those many developers that I would not invest in Bangalore. Sure. These are good quality developers. They have put in the right infrastructure within their schemes.
Is it fair to say Bangalore, from real estate point of view, is a cleaner market?
Absolutely. Absolutely. It is a cleaner market from every aspect of it. One is on the delivery. Second is, you know, they haven't been greedy on price rises. Mm. Also, the transactions are very clean. In there. Mostly they also know that these are, majority of the people are not business people, they're salaried people. So, you know, very, very nice. The only thing I would say of Bangalore is the infrastructure in there.
You know, but you know, Anuj, if we consider this, and again, I traveled to Bangalore, we met people, we met citizens. Citizens are upset. I'm upset. I'm a citizen of Bangalore. I'm upset. But the truth is, in spite of the bad infrastructure, we've seen the city do so well. In spite of, you know, the apathy from the government entirely, that doesn't seem like it cares at all at this point, we've seen the city do so well. So if at some point in the future, the government does manage to fix a road and build a flyover, then we'll get amazing returns from that real estate.
You're absolutely right. Absolutely. I mean, this is despite the infrastructure, what is there. I think it's just the talent base is so high and so dynamic and so diverse. That it really propagates. Plus, also, naturally, the weather is nice. The people are much more nicer, Faye, so you'll be glad to hear that.
I agree with you.
And also, you know, the entertainment, the social fabric, that's sure. very nice. So you're absolutely right. If the government was to put in the physical infrastructure, I think that city can do even better than what it did in 2015.
Is there a particular neighborhood that you're eyeing in Bangalore right now?
I would go towards North Bangalore, you know, really from Hebbal towards the airport. I think that's where you're going to see a fair amount of development. There are large industrial plots that sure. are coming up for disposition. A number of developers are eyeing those plots. That's as and when those plots get sold and a good developer buys that and launches a scheme, I think as a buyer, you should look at investing there.
All right. And of course, on Magicbricks Now, we're India's only property news channel. So if those industrial plots do get sold, you'll hear it first on this channel. So we're focusing on North Bangalore, Hebbal, Hennur, Tanisandra. These are the neighborhoods. There's a lot of construction. There's a lot of supply. Prices are also very attractive at this point. So that's where you should be looking at if you're looking to make an investment in Bangalore. I'm told that we have another phoner on the line. Mukund. Mukund is on the phone line from Mumbai. Mukund, tell us what your question is.
I'm from Mumbai.
Yes.
And my question to the panelist was that when we are saying the rate of the locality, say if you define the rate of Borivali area or suburban of Mumbai, mm-hmm. there is a lot of parity in rate that in a high-rise tower, the rates are quite high, whereas we get 2 BHK, 3 BHK, 3 crores. And same way, in the same lane, it's a small building, you get in a lesser rate of the same carpet area. So we fail to understand why so much of rate differences are there and why we are getting the rate on the Magicbricks slides which have been shown there. As some rate which is not which is prevailing in the market. Actual groundwork rates are different, actually.
All right. So to be fair, the rate that you're seeing on the screen right now, Mukund, is an average rate of the listings on the website, Magicbricks, that comes in from our partner from the website. But of course, rates, Anuj, will differ based on amenities, based on the builder. And we've seen there's a 20% difference right now between builders of reputation and those who are not as well known. So tell us what goes into actually determining the rate of a particular apartment.
A lot of things. And Faye, what you're saying is correct. And what the phoner is also saying is correct. I mean, both the statements are true. Very difficult to identify that in a larger micro market, what is the rate? So you're right. It has to be an average rate. Otherwise, then you do building by building. And building by building, the rate will vary depending on what's the infrastructure, what are the facilities, what's the community who's living in there, what's the upgrade, what's the management, what's the carpet area to the built-up area ratio, where the building is located in comparison to the school, to the hospital, mm-hmm. to the highway, to the train station, how many occupiers in that building are wanting to sell their apartments. So there is a huge amount of variation
and
from a building to building.
And whether or not the builder is making any sales.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's provided the builder has some stock. In many of these buildings, the builder has sold it. So really, it's a secondary transaction that you're doing it. And secondary transaction, very difficult to find out what's the exact rate. I mean, Borivali is still an easier example that, you can do a range of, say, between 10,000 to 17,000-18,000 rupees, and you'll be able to cover, say, 80% of the market.
Sure.
But, Faye, you take South Bombay. South Bombay, you would vary from anywhere between 30,000 rupees to 150,000 rupees per square foot. So very difficult to say is that, Magicbricks needs to give one rate in South Bombay. Difficult, but equally I can understand from a consumer's perspective. They are looking at it, but, the building that I have, that rate is showing 50,000. You're showing it at 70,000. Why there is that difference?
Just from this question, I want to take another question through. Pranay, if you can tell us this. Obviously, there's a massive difference right now, like I said, about 20-25% between a builder of reputation and right next door, anybody else who's building next to him. As a consumer, should I be willing to part with that extra 25% just to bring down my risk?
No, I would say your scrutiny, your investigation will have to be a lot more when you're getting something for 20% cheaper. Mm. What is the delivery date? What is the schedule of payment? How many people have bought it? Who are going to be your neighbors? Because the gentry is the thing which really determines the price. How much has he sold? How much is still to go? The number of questions you'll have to ask, including the legal aspect of titles. Is it a slum redevelopment project or is it on a virgin land? What was it? You know, all of those questions need to be answered to get that 20% discount that you're looking at, you know, compared to your neighbor.
So a 20% discount should make me even more vigilant, is what you're saying.
Absolutely.
All right. Mukund, do you have any more questions for us?
I have one more point in this.
Okay.
In the same gentry, same locality, same building, same tier one builder, quality builder, if the builder is selling at X rate, but we are getting X minus 20 by the investor or by the, you know, when the position takes place, we get X minus 30. How you will define that, whether it is a, what is the solution for this type of, we see a lot of options today available where a builder is putting X rate, and X minus 20, X minus 30 sold by the investor.
Sure.
Yeah, and I'm happy to take that question. It is true. Less prevalent though in Bombay, you know, was hugely prevalent in North. You know, Noida, Gurgaon, Greater Noida market. And the reason for that was that there was bulk sale that was done by the builder to investors. In effect, it wasn't really a sale, because the investor was also competing with the developer and bringing out the inventory. And it is true that the developer would continue to increase its price and the developer would always be at a lower price and first sell that inventory. If you are a buyer, please go to that investor and buy it. There is no difference between the two products as long as the investor has a right to sell the product. I would say is go ahead and do that. Builders also know that until the investor is able to sell their full stock, their stock is not going to sell. And they literally quote a price fully knowing that they're not going to be able to make the sale. Once the investor stock goes away, that's when the builder stock starts to sell.
All right, we're running out of time. I have 10 minutes more on this show, and I want to quickly squeeze in options in Hyderabad and in the NCR region. Since you brought it up, Anuj, the NCR, I think the bigger problem, more than location, the bigger problem is picking the builder right now in the NCR, because people are terrified. Customers are terrified of winding up in one of those situations where there's no construction, you don't know what to do, you have to go to consumer court. Nobody wants to wind up there. You just want to be able to pay for a home that you receive. How would you advise a buyer to navigate this market in 2016?
And in Faye, NCR is perhaps the most toughest market, most difficult market. It's also a market that has been hit hard in 2015 and 2014. It's also a market that was perhaps the most unregulated. You know, certainly if you were to go into Noida and Greater Noida, you're going to get a lot of fly-by-night operators who had very little money. The government was giving land on lease to be paid over 7 years. They paid the first or the second installment, started to do a little bit of development, sell the apartments, and then have disappeared.
Sure.
So very, very tough market. I would say stay with very well-known developers. A lot that we discussed on the show.
Should we buy at all in the NCR region, or would you say hold off, wait, if you can wait 6-8 months to just see
I
how
would
this
say
turns
is,
out?
You know, Faye, there are still a lot of good developers. I mean, there's Tata's, there's Godrej, there's Mahindra's, there's, you know, several other players who are quality developers, who are corporates, who have done well in the past. I wouldn't hesitate in going out and doing that buy of those developers. But that's a market which has got a lot of fly-by-night. So you have to really be very careful when you're going out and buying in that market. So I wouldn't be hesitant, but I would be more cautious than I would necessarily be of Bangalore.
Much more cautious than you'd be of Bangalore. Be really circumspect. I mean, just because you've heard the brand of the builder does not mean that you know, you should go ahead. Just because you see a fancy brochure or an AV does not mean you should go ahead. You must have a lawyer look through everything, especially in the NCR region. Pranay, what's your recommendation on location in NCR?
The NCR?
Yep.
One is the golf course extension.
Okay.
You know, that's one of them, which is likely to appreciate more than others. And I would say that the new Gurgaon, sectors 81 and 95.
Okay. Is there a reason why?
Again, you know, the base price is small and it's likely to go up. Infrastructure, all of that put together.
All right, New Gurgaon and the golf course extension. Golf course extension is a little expensive, but I'm assuming that you expect it to go up even further from where it is right now?
Right. It's about between 7,000 and 8,000 rupees, depending upon what you're looking at. And it's likely to go up, according to one analysis, to almost about 11,000 to 12,000 rupees.
In how long?
In about 4 to 5 years.
In about 4 to 5 years. Or
so will
the average fixed deposit in about 4 to 5 years. So you should keep that in mind if you're making that investment. Let's also very quickly talk about Hyderabad. Anuj, Hyderabad is the dark horse at this point. You can buy great construction in Banjara Hills or Jubilee Hills in Hyderabad for something that you'd have to pay for Mira Road in Mumbai. Do you think it makes sense to go out and buy Hyderabad at this point?
So again, it is a dark horse affair, and I think with the two states now split, there is a fair amount of focus on both the states.
And it's currently, I mean, for the time being, the capital for both states.
It's capital for both the states. And we're seeing a huge amount of increased activity from our IT occupier clients who are wanting to now expand. There was always a talent base. It was a great infrastructure that had been already put into place. It was a hub of IT. In the last 4 or 5 years, because of the issues between the two states, it had not progressed. Given that that is now sorted out, you're going to see a fair amount of activity. I would be a big proponent of the Gachibowli area.
Okay.
I think it's a great area to get in, and it's a great time to get into Hyderabad.
Pranay, do you agree, Gachibowli?
Yeah, I think it's a good area. Except that something else which we talked about a little bit earlier, you mentioned water. And I think that's also very important
for
Hyderabad.
But that's true of all of Hyderabad, specifically Gachibowli. There's no water in the whole city.
I think as long as you're more water at some place compared to others, it's a preferred location, I would say.
All right, so Gachibowli in Hyderabad, closer to Hyderabad.
There's one more area, which is Kopalguda.
Kopalguda, okay. Yeah. All right, so Kopalguda and Gachibowli, both close to the high-tech city, wherever. Actually, the string that has come through all of this is wherever the IT, ITS guys are going, that's where you should follow. There doesn't seem to be any other industry for the time being driving the real estate market in any of our cities, Bangalore being the brightest star, Hyderabad the dark bet that's coming up. If you have questions for us on Magicbricks Now, you know how to get in touch. We'll put our contact details on your screen. Right through the new year, we're going to be here to help you buy your home. The unanimous advice you're getting from across this channel, from everybody who's been on so far, is that if you're looking for your first home or a home that you want to live in, now is the time to go out and buy. Good developer, as close to occupancy as possible. Make sure he has all of his permissions. Anuj and Pranay, happy new year to the two of you. And thank you so much for spending time with us on Magicbricks Now. Thank you for watching.
Thank you.